excited to have with us today Theresia Gouw, founding partner at Acrew Capital, to talk about the state of venture capital right now. Theresia, maybe just to set the stage, you know, the last year has obviously been an incredibly volatile one for venture capital, particularly within tech. You know, we saw record-breaking levels of fundraising. At the same time, there were several major private companies, not just WeWork, that failed to go public as planned. And private and venture capital funding actually declined for the first time since 2016. Taking all of that together, how would you describe sort of the state of venture capital now? And more importantly, maybe, what does 2020 look like?
It's interesting. I think that actually 2019 was a really strong year for venture overall. And the slight downturn, which I believe it was about $4 billion less in venture funding in 2019 versus 18, can almost 100% be accounted for by the drop, slight drop, in what are the super late stage mega deals. And this ties into your point about WeWork and some of the other companies. So yeah, interestingly, the Series A side, which is where Acrew and I focus, that actually went up in terms of venture funding, 19 versus 18, by about $4 billion. Whereas mega deals, which are $500 million deals or more, went down by $5 billion. So almost the entire drop in venture overall can be accounted for by these late stage rounds. But so I think that's a little bit what we're seeing. So, and there's plenty of money for early stage companies. I think there's still plenty of money for late stage companies too, but there just might still be a little bit of public-private disconnect.
Yeah, so a lot to dig into there, but I do want to start with the fact that you have just founded a new company, or a new fund. You've described Acrew as being multi-generational, still focused on early stage capital. What was it you wanted to do differently with Acrew?
So the multi-generational is literally true. I am now the old person, the oldest person amongst my five co-founders at the firm. And we literally represent three generations, Gen X, Y, and Z, in our founding team. And look, in my experience in venture, I think that that's a real competitive advantage, both today, but certainly in the future. If you think about generational transition, which is always hard in a small partnership type of endeavor, and we've seen recently some pretty public generational transitions that did not necessarily take. So I think we're well positioned for the future because we start out on day one. It won't be a transition, eventually when I'm ride off into the sunset, it's not that my other partners won't have been right with me shoulder to shoulder making with equal decision-making decisions and firm creation decisions like they did from the start. So that's that. And then today, frankly, in today's market, I mean, I think it gives us a huge advantage, particularly in some of the sectors that we spend time in. So we're focused on early stage, primarily Series A, all software. Our two biggest sectors are cybersecurity and infrastructure, which myself and one of my other partners, Mark, leads. Big guess, we're the Gen Xers. But then the next equal largest area is fintech, which is actually led by my partners, Lauren and Vishal, who are of a different generation. And I think a lot of the really interesting new companies that are being created there are being founded both by, but also marketed to this generation. So that's not even getting to sort of the consumer internet stuff, which, obviously back in the day when Trulia or Hotel Tonight, but now I think sort of the next opportunity is actually creating new consumer platforms that are driven by what this generation, both the Gen Y and Gen Z, much more around experiential experiences as opposed to tangible goods, and I think that has some interesting potential opportunities and implication for this next crop of consumer internet companies.
In forming Acrew, you put together a diverse team. I mean, we've all seen the studies on that show that diverse investment teams generate better performance. Companies with diverse boards outperform those without them. How important was that for you, given the experience that you've had over the years, over the course of your career, and what role does that play in the firms that you want to invest in?
So I think there's been a ton of studies that show the bottom line financial results. So hopefully in 2020, we don't have to justify why it's, a good thing as a venture capitalist, stressing the second word. It's like, that's my job is to make money for my investors. So I think there's enough data there. So what I also saw over the last 4 to 5 years in working with this group, which was different than most VC firms. So I think as most people know, it's improving. It's gone, I think, from 9% to 11% of VC partners and, you know, check writers are female. But what that actually means is that about 3/4 of venture firms have no female investing partners. Yeah. And perhaps not a surprise, because I very much view the entrepreneurial community and the VC community as, you know, two sides of the same coin, or a virtuous circle, or whatever you want to use as your analogy, that unfortunately most VC companies, I think it's gone up from 11% to 15% to now, I think, almost 19% of venture-backed companies have a female founder or co-founder. Without having an explicit diversity or gender lens, and there are some great funds who do that, our firm was able to attract because of who we are, it's mostly deal referrals, just like everything else in the investment business. And so over the last 4 to 5 years, we've actually found that both our deal flow and the companies that we funded, 40 to 45% of the founders, depending on the year that you're looking at, have a female founder. And that is sticking to our core sector, some of which are pretty deep and geeky, like cybersecurity and infrastructure. Yeah. And it's really just speaks to, if you have a different set of people at the table, who they're going to know and who will, you know, be referred to you and come into the door, and therefore your opportunity set is broader. And we think that's a real advantage, because we get, you know, a broader first look at a lot of companies that perhaps some other very good firms won't get, because they don't have the connectivity to those folks. And the generational piece plays into that too. Those numbers are, for a bunch of reasons, harder to report.
You know, growth capital, if that's what you can even call, you know, tens of billions of dollars going into multi-tens of billions of dollars funds or firms, has been a big part of where we've seen growth in venture capital, at least in terms of the reported numbers over the last few years. How do you think about sort of the role that you want growth to play in the firm? And you know, more broadly, how do you think about the health of that end of the market of venture capital, and kind of what that means for VC?
So we've explicitly focused at the other extreme of that, which is Series A, and this leads to sort of, so the short answer is, I think there are some really great and strong growth stage investors. I do think that, as I've observed over the last 20 years, but most dramatically over the last 5 to 10 years, there's been a massive increase in the dollars dedicated to late stage, and therefore an attendant increase. Now, you never know which one came first, the chicken or the egg, and much, much larger growth rounds. Like you said, like a growth round used to be 50 million, and now by the VC reporting, they start at 500 million is when they start considering that. And so what we saw, and why we're focused on the early stages, we actually saw a move like white space. So I think, like most founders, they like see a white space in the market, and that's where they go to. And I call it a little bit, I feel like it's back to the future, like what the late 90s was when I first entered the venture business. So as huge increase in the number of very good seed funds, as well as sophisticated angel investors, which is terrific. This massive increase in the dollars available for late stage. And then many firms going to multi-stage, including my prior firm, which is a great strategy if you want to become the Goldman Sachs of, as the equivalent, right? You want to be the big player. But fewer players focus solely on the Series A. So we saw that as a real opportunity. They're actually, relatively speaking, even though the dollars in Series A went up and are at an all-time high, 19 versus 18, the number of firms that exclusively focus on that stage is far less than what it was in the late 90s when I entered the business. So that's what I see as the opportunity. And again, I still think that there's plenty of opportunity at the earlier stages. And I think there are some great later stage companies that have decided to remain private that aren't public yet. But I do think that the amount of dollars there can potentially, with certain management teams, create problems. Because I always like to advise my companies, like, when whatever round it is, whether it's A, B, C, or EE, that, you know, what you're trying to raise should be based on what you need to achieve the next set of milestones, whatever that next milestone is, right? It might be a next round, or it might be going public. With some modest cushion measured in smallish percents, right, like 10, 20%. But not to raise too much more than that, because I think that overcapitalization can potentially lead to, lack of sharpness on management focus and expense. Like, just because you have more cash resources, the hard thing to scale, I think any entrepreneur will tell you, or board, like, the hardest thing to scale is executive and management talent and capability there. So just because you have, just because you thought you were going to raise $200 million and you have $300 million, it's unlikely that you will actually be able to either achieve your goals faster or that you've increased the success of achieving those goals, because you can't actually grow your management team by 50% by snapping your fingers, right? That's the limiting factor. And so not always, but it can be, right? It's kind of like if the money's sitting there, it's hard not to think about ways you could try to accelerate your business, which is great if you've got the management capability to do so, but that's the hardest thing to scale.
Mm-hmm. Here recently, another early stage venture capital firm shared that over the last 15 years, they've seen the time between first contact to term sheet in their portfolio go from 90 days to 9. I guess first, are you seeing that in your own experience, broader experience? And two, does that create risks in the system in terms of your and your colleagues' ability to do the kind of diligence that you want to be able to do and that you need to be able to do to kind of ensure the quality of your portfolio?
Yeah, so, and I think the study you're talking about is from first round. They're great team, I respect them a lot. So I don't have the same quantitative data that they do, but qualitatively, especially it's 15 years ago. So if I think back to 2004 to 2005, is there a shorter time to decision or time to term sheet than there was then? Absolutely. And I think they're right to look at that, because I always think of that as like the leading indicator. In LPs often want to know what the pre-money valuations are. That's a lagging indicator. Right. So it's definitely increased a lot, which makes sense, because you may remember, I know you and I remember.
Yeah.
2004, 2005, we were still really coming off of the lows of 2000, 2001, and just beginning to make, particularly in the consumer internet sector, which had fallen very out of favor, right? So like our Series A investment in Facebook was in 2005, Series A investment in Julia in 2000. So it was just beginning to come again. So I would not be surprised that it's 1/10 as long as before. I don't know, I can't comment on 9 days or not. What I'll say is that it's, even if it's 9 days, it's not as bad as it was in 99, when literally some of was like measured in hours. Like there were like, and most funds, most very active funds in 99 invested their entire fund in less than one calendar year, which speaks to how, you know, how quickly decisions were being made, how quickly deals were being taken off the table. Thankfully, we're not at those times yet. But a lesson learned from that, and that we use in our firm, is I think two things. So one is, you know, it's not just that we focus on these five thematic areas: cybersecurity, infrastructure, fintech, future of work, which is basically SaaS software, data platforms, and consumer internet connected communities. But we actually, and we just did this a few weeks ago, we actually proactively try to identify specific subsectors and companies ahead of time before they're doing the financing. So a way we try to mitigate this shorter time to decision is fully half of the companies that we meet with, even when it's the first meeting, it's not really the first meeting. Like, we've been looking at that sector, we've been maybe even looking at that company, talking to that company in between fundraisings, so that if they do have a 9-day fundraising time period, it's not really the first time we've interacted at a minimum with that subsector. So we're very proactive about that. That's a good mitigating strategy when you're in an environment that's extremely fast moving and very much on the entrepreneur side. So we as investors need to be more prepared in advance. And then the second thing we do is we, you know, talked about our fund size and our team size. We now increased to 6 investors on the investing team. We're still relatively small, and that's by design. That is so that we can make decisions quickly. We are all involved in making final investment decisions, and we can all get together like that. And when, you know, each sub-team focus area has 2 to 3 people on it. So half of the people have actually already been thinking about this company in that space before we have our first meeting. So that's how we try to prepare ourselves as best we can. So I hope it doesn't go from nine days to 9 hours like it was in 1999, but we'll be about as prepared as we can be.
Gotcha. So having just launched the fund, where are the opportunities that you looked at now? You touched on the themes. Where are you focused?
So I've touched on the themes. So very specifically, you know, like I've always been very, very focused in cybersecurity, continue to be very excited about that. Also excited about the applications. I know people have talked a lot about the applications of AI and ML. And we're really interested in companies that are taking those same AI substrates, as I call them, or platforms, and building either vertical applications on top of that. So for example, in fintech, we have a couple of really interesting companies that are using machine learning on top of the platforms that exist out there and using new pools of data that didn't used to be available to a lot of fintech companies and creating real-time credit decisioning and underwriting algorithms, not only for themselves, but they've opened up that platform to other companies who want the ability to include real-time machine learning-based credit decisioning into their credit offerings, whether that's for credit cards or loans or otherwise. So I think that's an example of places where we're super excited in the shorter term. I do believe that the time is right for, I know we talked about this, I think there will be another wave of the next gen of the consumer internet companies. It's like been out of favor for long enough. Mm-hmm. I'm never good with market timing, you might be better. I don't know if it's gonna happen this year or next year, but I can tell you in looking at the early company formation, it's just starting to bubble back up again. So I think we're headed on the upswing.
Yeah, you touched on AI, but as you look further out, are there emerging technologies, you know, whether it's, you know, where AI is going, quantum, blockchain, robotics, machine vision, biology, that you're particularly interested in, but just haven't found the right investment yet?
So for a while now, we've been particularly interested in blockchain, and I'm glad you said blockchain, not cryptocurrency.
Learned my lesson.
What we've done is and this is what we do whenever we're creating a new proactive investment theme, it's what we did that created some of the ones we have now, is we'll often start, while we're Series A firm, we'll often start by making seed investments alongside some other great seed funds like the First Rounds and others of the world. So we started doing seed investments in blockchain about 2 years ago. And some of them worked out, some of them didn't. Even then, we view it as infrastructure. We don't know which applications, which is how we think of crypto, we don't know which applications are gonna be the ones that end up being winners, but it reminds me in this way back to sort of, you know, the late 90s of like, the internet's gonna be a thing. So blockchain is gonna be an important kind of transport layer, if you will, for enterprises. And so let's just figure out people who are selling great, what we think of as picks and shovels, because we don't know where the gold's gonna hit, but people gotta buy picks and shovels.
Theresia, thanks for taking so much time to join us. I think we all look forward to seeing how this goes.
Thanks for having me.